For Miranda, tapu ingoa, tihe maori ora, greetings everybody from Albany Senior High School. I want to acknowledge as well that this is not my story alone. The rangatira Tumuaki is here, who founded the school with me, in terms of the leadership and the development of the direction that we took. Introducing Albany Senior High School, it was the first state-funded senior high school established in New Zealand about 11 years ago. And with that came some huge opportunities and responsibilities. I mean, it was an opportunity for us to reimagine what a senior school could be like. And I know a lot of you will have experienced that the pedagogical approaches and the innovations that often happen are at junior levels. As soon as you get to a senior level and it becomes high stakes, that wonderful, innovative practice, that part that was really engaging and that students are really wanting to do, gets left to the side. And we even see that moving from primary schools up to secondary schools. We have a lot to learn from our primary colleagues. So, you know, we had an opportunity to think about what was the meaning of education, what is the purpose of education. Surely, one of the key purposes of education is to enable our students to move across life stage with dignity, purpose, and options. But that doesn't happen everywhere. And it was our chance to actually think about how do we make that happen for every single student that crosses our threshold at Albany Senior High School. How do we put the students at the centre? And quite honestly, that is what has directed our innovations. So our approach is by placing students at the centre, looking to research, looking to experts, looking to colleagues in other innovative schools, and also talking with our community to design a curriculum, which was, and still is, 10 years later, quite different from a typical secondary school curriculum approach. With students at the centre, I'll give you an example of that. At a senior school level, you may be familiar with streaming or students having to pass particular levels to access the next step. At Albany Senior, we don't do that. By putting students at the centre, we believe that we need to have a conversation with our students to find out, well, what do they really want to do, what are their goals, and we will not deny them access to the subjects that they want, that they need to achieve and to get there. Another thing we do is we actually, we personalise their achievement programmes, we personalise their assessments, so that we are focused on strengths, their strengths and their success. The three strands are specialist subjects, which we're all very familiar with, tutorials, where that level of personalisation for success happens. That is where a student has access to one key advocate, a key teacher. One teacher has maybe 15 students across three levels, and they advocate for those students and they personalise where that success may be for those students. They set goals, there's a lot of the pastoral work that happens and that key connection home. We are very connected with home, which I think is a New Zealand way of being, a whānau way of being. And the one aspect I want to spend a little bit more time on, which was a particular innovation and very different, I think, from what's typically happening in New Zealand schools, but also in other project-based learning schools, is the Impact Project. And we named that Impact Projects because we really do want to encourage our students to have an impact now, not when they leave school. So Impact Projects, every Wednesday, all day on a Wednesday, and it is student-directed project-based learning. It is a senior school. So we're opening up the space to let our students bring who they are into their learning. We don't want the kind of comments like Stephen Fry saying, I was successful in spite of school. We don't want people going away and working on computers at night and in their garages because the school curriculum doesn't allow them to do that in that space. We want our students to pursue how they fit in the world, how they are bright in the world, and it breathes life into that statement, it is not if you are bright, it is how you are bright. So impact projects, a full day on a Wednesday, that's more time than we dedicate to the specialist subjects, each specialist subject. And I tell you what, when you give students that kind of autonomy, that kind of power, it is amazing what happens. And you take away the pressure of assessments. You just take the lid off these kids' learning. It is learning without limits. It is the space where a kid goes in and thinks, actually, I think I might want to be an early childhood educator, goes and works in a early childhood program and realises that she hates kids. It is a really good experience to have before you dedicate your time. So on that Wednesday, we do project-based learning, and we also have a Pathways program called Gateway, where students can intern, where they can spend 13 of their 26 weeks actually really getting used to being in the work environment and finding out if that's what they want to do. And they have 6 opportunities to do that over the course of the 3 years that they are with us. So half-year projects, student-directed. I wanted to show you just the range of things that people do, and I've got some cards that I'll just hand out later, so you can have a look at what these kids do, because it's phenomenal. I mean, we have a young group of students, Asian students actually, and they're creating a database so that, because we have a huge number of diverse cultures attending Albany, and so there's the pronunciation of people's names, and that's actually really important that you get that right. So they've created a database which is interactive, and so you can actually go and find students and teachers, and the students and teachers are pronouncing their names for you, so you can learn them. We have a group there that are doing virtual reality gaming, and they actually have done a scare game, a horror game. So you're walking along finding things, and then all of a sudden there's something that comes out and tries to hit you. And you can't run away, actually. I have Rabia there who wants to be a doctor. So she's investigating salt and how that enables hydration, so electrolytes. So she's investigating that. She's doing a Silver Crest Award, which is creativity in science and technology. The young man over in the far corner is actually, he's developing a prototype to try and stop the issue of kauri dieback. The kauri tree is a native tree of New Zealand. It is iconic, and it is at the moment, its population is being devastated by this disease. And so we need to find a solution, and the authorities haven't. He's working with the authorities on this. We have a young woman who has actually done up one mini. She brought it in to showcase just recently, and she's now working on a camper van. And the highlight for her is that she's actually building a really strong relationship with her father, which she loves. And this example, I think, is really beautiful. We have a hospital for children called Starship Hospital. And we have these young women who are so, they're dramatic and they love drama and they love theatre. And what they've been doing is going in every Wednesday and teaching these students about theatre and about acting. And the joy that these young people have, because they are able to just leave themselves behind, you know, and forget about what's going on in their lives and just really play together, it is phenomenal. And the parents really, it really matters to them that their kids can be kids and not have the weight of what's, you know, that anticipation on their shoulders the whole time. So that gives you a range. But we have about 750 students at Albany Senior, and we are responding to these projects. They can be by themselves, they can be in groups. So we have a lot of projects that we actually have to work alongside. We also require our students to be working with the community. So we have some pillars or principles that we work to. There must be student agency and ownership. There has to be substantial learning beyond the scope of the classroom. If you can learn it in math or in science, then it's not enough. It needs to be where the subjects come together and there's that creative space in between. How do things connect up? We want our students participating in the world now, not waiting until they leave. It's not good enough. We want them to be leaders now. So we want them connecting with the experts, connecting with universities and having stakeholders. And then we want quality products at the end, something tangible that they can show they have created.
But it's not assessed, am I right?
It's not necessary. We actually give them the option, but the kids don't want it. So, I mean, it's the one place that they can play. And I actually think that's really important because everything else that they do is assessed. Everything else. So this is the place where actually as the, how a student is in the world can be totally changed. And I've got stories of that kind of transformational experience that students have had. Just very quickly, a young woman in my tutorial class, Destiny Ririkura, a young Māori woman, really found it hard to get to school. She just couldn't deal with it. Her specialist subjects, I was always ringing home and trying to get her in, and it was without success. But she decided, or we decided together, that I would, I really needed a chicken coop. I haven't got chickens yet. I will have chickens at some stage, but not yet. But, you know, and she had a passion for hard technology, but she hadn't followed through in the senior years. And we thought, that's fine. But for Destiny, every Wednesday, she would turn up and she would work on this chicken coop with experts, because I don't know the first thing about all of that, you know, nails and stuff. And she would, she actually produced this amazing piece after prototyping at scale for me, which I took home. We also showcased, I just thought this was useful because it shows you her learning journey. So she does this as a website, and there's her prototyping, her research, her reflections, and everything else that can then be published and shared with home. Wednesday was the only day she turned up for school. It was her proudest piece that she had produced. And this brings me on to the journey that I'm on currently, which I think is a little bit different and I think is probably useful to share, is that we created this space, which is very different from a traditional space for teachers. You can't go into impact projects and be the expert. It's not like teaching a specialist subject. So what we have found is that some students fly. They have these transformational experiences, but some students don't. So as a teacher, and we call them mentors in this space, as a mentor, how do you build your capability? How do you build your approaches to enable every student to have a quality experience? And that is where the work has been. We've got structures, we've got ways of being and you know, rubrics and ways of judging work and how to move on work, but actually, as teachers, how do you empower teachers to be in that space and to do a good job? Because they don't know. So the first part of the journey that I've been on this year was actually defining with staff, well, what is our pedagogical approach? We want to build partnerships with our students in this space and in tutorials. We want to actively co-design the work, because it's no good having a student going off and we say that's agentic, but we don't know what they're doing. It's almost like abandonment. So we want to co-design, and we want the opportunities to be deep for these students. So now we have our desired approach. We used a theory of action model to develop this together, and it is a really useful model in terms of being quite analytical and deliberate about how we go about things. So the next step is, okay, so we know what the desired approach is, but how do you help people to get there? And if you read that, I'm sure some of you have experienced this in your professional learning moments. That tentative place between life and death is very similar sometimes to those professional development moments. Death, it would be so subtle, that crossover. So we have been using a model which is actually very much putting the teacher at the heart of this. The teacher is the expert. The responses that the teacher has to be in context. They can't just be one size fits all, because we know it doesn't. So we are using this teaching as inquiry model. Actually, there's another model that we also are looking to, which is the spirals of inquiry, to build teacher capabilities with the idea that we want to be working in partnership with our students. So a teacher, for example, may begin with an idea, actually, I'm doing learning journeys, but this is not in partnership with my students. So what might I need to change? How could I shift that? So the current approach and then the desired approach. This is just the focusing and thinking about it. How could I change this? And then actually working with the students who you're focusing on, who you want to change your approach for and want to make a difference for, talking with them. Well, how might I change this approach? I want to be working with you more. What's not working for you at the moment? What do they have to say about this crisis of your practice that you have identified? And then the next part, because I'm racing through, this is, you know, just a once over lightly, really. We need to also think about, well, if we're trying to create change, how do we know change has happened for these students? So getting some information from them before you think about the change that you're going to implement, and then after to see if there is any difference. You can see that this is just a continuation of that we want our students to be working in partnership. So in the middle, you're negotiating and working alongside your mentor to develop the work that you're producing. A word that we use to describe this is stopping the routine practice, stopping people going back to the same ways that they've always done things, going to the same toolkit. We need to expand the toolkit if it's not working, and we're trying to, through this model, develop adaptive expertise. And that just gives you a brief overview of that. Really important that they don't just think they're changing things and then that's done, that you're actually looking to see what the impact is, and then you're thinking, well, how do I change my practice? How might I, you know, what's worth keeping? And how do I improve it and refine it? We need to celebrate our teachers' learning as well. So we make sure our teachers are showcasing and sharing the work that they do with each other. I mean, we've got to share the gold. We've got to scale it up. And we don't have all the answers in this space because it's such a new space. So we share the gold, we present what we're doing, we talk about the students that we've been working with, and the students know that they're in partnership with us. And the other thing we do is we do write up the work that we've done and we share it on a library database so that the information can be found. And so we keep that and can continue to learn from each other when it's right. We also are beginning to develop a system of ensuring that information follows particular students, because we actually, over 50% of our students choose to come to us because they don't fit into a normal system. Some of our students are very quirky and very different, and we love them very much. Some of our students, this is their last hope. They've been kicked out of most of the other schools and the other opportunities. This is it. So we want to make sure if we find something that works for these kids that it follows them and that we're sharing that knowledge together. So we also use PAMA. You know, if we want our students' experiences to be responsive and to feel valued and to have dignity, we also need to make sure that our teachers have the same kinds of learning experiences, that they feel valued and that they have dignity and are empowered. And I feel that this is the beginning of the journey that we're on, and we're certainly not there yet. Thanks.